people of God, and welcome to this communion service. If you intend to celebrate communion with me later in this service, make sure that you have your bread and wine or the substitute you are going to use handy before you watch this any further. May Holy Spirit unite us over time and space so that we can be together as body of Christ as we read from the Word and as we celebrate communion together. Let us pray first. Almighty, holy, ever-present God, thank you for giving us this opportunity to get together around your word and around your table. Make these for each of us holy moments in your presence. We come to you just as we are. Please speak to us. Strengthen our relationship with you and strengthen our faith with you, Lord. Thank you for the sacrifice you made on the cross. Thank you that we can live victorious as your people who were raised with Jesus Christ. Help us to live like people who have won the prize, people of the kingdom. Lord, please bless us as we read from your word, reflect on it, and celebrate communion together. Amen. Friends, let's now sing Bless the Lord, or also known as 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord.
His holy name. Sing like
Today our scripture reading is from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. One day Moses was tending the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led the flock far into the wilderness and came to Sinai, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the middle of a bush. Moses stared in amazement. Though the bush was engulfed in flames, it didn't burn up. "This is amazing," Moses said to himself. "Why isn't the bush burning up? I must go and see it." When the Lord saw Moses coming to take a closer look, God called to him from the middle of the bush. "Moses, Moses."
"Here I am," Moses replied.
"Do not come any closer," the Lord warned. "Take off your sandals, for you are standing on holy ground. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." When Moses heard this, he covered his face because he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord told him, "I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their cries of distress because of their harsh slave drivers. Yes, I am aware of their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious land. It is a land flowing with milk and honey, the land where the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites now live. Look, the cry of the people of Israel has reached me, and I have seen how harshly the Egyptians abuse them. Now go, for I am sending you to Pharaoh. You must lead my people, Israel, out of Egypt." May God bless this word into our lives. Just before lockdown, Kingsley Electrical, a business who existed for 75 years, had to close their doors. And the reason they couldn't do business anymore is because it is easier and cheaper to go and buy a new appliance rather than bring it to them to be repaired. This is telling of our society, which increasingly seems to demand the quick fix and the immediate alleviation of discomfort and pain with as little effort as possible, so that we can carry on with our lives, so that we can do what we want to do. I think this is one of the reasons that we struggle with COVID-19. There is no quick fix. The illness has got a restricted effect and impact on all our lives. It has a definite long-term fiscal implication for many generations to come. No easy fix. We all must sacrifice and work together for the greater good of all. The question, though, does our quick fix, easy as possible living attitude and expectations impact our faith? I think so. We expect God to quickly fix whatever is wrong and eliminate all struggle and suffering. God is expected to take away all pain, struggle, helplessness, brokenness in our world, unfairness, all the struggles we expect God to just take away. And when this does not happen, doubt, rejection, and disillusionment sets in. Then we hear people say, "It's just a fairy tale," or perhaps God doesn't exist. If he exists, why don't we see his love? Or perhaps even, why bother? Ultimately, within this frame of mind, happiness, health, well-being, and peace are seen as signs of God's presence, God's care, and love. On the other hand, unhappiness, sickness, struggle, and strife are experienced as the absence of God, or at least the absence of God's love. For some time before God in this scene reached out to Moses,
to lead his people out of Egypt, the people of Israel has been suffering harshly. Their suffering was not a punishment. They simply became a threat because they multiplied and they became a strong people. The Pharaoh felt threatened by the fact that they might turn against him and that they may be stronger than him. So he tried to break them and break them down. They were enslaved and subjected to harsh slave drivers. The government's policy was to do anything in their power to prevent them from becoming stronger, prevent them from becoming more. They tried to wear them down with crushing labor. They made their lives bitter and even went as far as killing newborn baby boys to prevent this people from becoming stronger and bigger. Their lives were not easy or good. They were severely oppressed, and daily living was an emotional and physical struggle. Within this context, God appearing to Moses in a burning bush was not really a quick fix either. God caught Moses' attention by letting this bush burn without burning out. Moses had to notice this burning bush, had to be curious about what this might mean, and had to go and investigate what's going on and what this might mean. It was when he did this that he put himself in a space where God could call to him and speak to him and tell him what he needs to do. God introduced himself as the covenant God, the God who promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to be their God and to give them a future. The God who is true to his promises in spite of us people being disloyal, being stubborn, being disobedient, not bringing our side. Despite everything, God is the God, the covenant God, who forgives and gives second chances. But it's also very clear that God is God, and that God needs to be revered. People need to have a deep and holy respect and admiration for God. People need to stand in awe of God. People need to know that God is so much more and so completely different from what we are. God has no boundaries and no limitations. God is not bound by time, space, scientific principles, or any of these concepts that we manage to get our heads around. Then this Almighty God said, "I've seen my people struggle and suffering. I've heard my people's cries and pleas. I'm aware that things are not good for them. I'm going to rescue them and bring them to a land of plenty." For this, God decided to use people, and I might add, very unwilling people. Moses was quick to explain why he is not the right person for the job, why he isn't able to do this task that God had for him. And on top of that, God didn't send Moses a very detailed email telling him what to do and how to go about it. Moses had to believe and trust God. Here we see the interaction between God's sovereignty and the freedom of people. But God convinced Moses to do that. And modern day people was likely to look at this scene and think, "Really? You, the Almighty, want to use a man who grew up as an Egyptian prince and who is now a shepherd working for his father-in-law? You want to use this man to rescue your people? And on top of that, this man has got a speech impediment And he's definitely not one of the most charismatic leaders around. Really, Lord? Is this the best plan you can come up with? That is what society seemed to think and to say. But who do we think we are? How arrogant can we get? Who are we as people to think that we know better than the Almighty God? Who are we to think that we can give God directions? Having faith is knowing that God is God, knowing who God is, but also knowing who we are. Faith means knowing that God is undefinable by human beings. Through our faith and God's revelation, we know some things about God. We know God is all-loving, eternal, all-perfect, all-merciful, all-good, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-present, all-forgiving. And we can continue on with this list for a long time. And after we've done all this, we still haven't described God for who God is. There is no way we can ever know better than God. As God's people, as Christians, we can approach the Almighty God and we can say to God, Lord, we do not understand. From our perspective, there seem to be a different way about this, a different way to do this, perhaps an easier way. Or that doesn't seem fair, Lord. Yes, we can express our frustration, our fears, our hurt. Yes, we can ask God to heal, to relieve, to protect, and to save. We can wrestle with God about challenges in our lives and in the world around us. But we find peace and comfort and hope and strength and everything we need, knowing that God loves us. God knows the best for us. God will take care of us. God is with us. Ultimately, we trust God. And because we know God uses people, you and I need to keep an eye out to see how God is trying to catch our attention. We need to be alert and aware that God is trying to make contact with us. Sometimes through scripture, other people, things that happen to us, in whichever way, we don't all get a burning bush. But it's important that we're aware that God is a God who seeks interaction and engagement with us. We need to notice. We need to be curious about what God might be saying to us through events or through whatever's happening. And we need to approach. We need to investigate this closer, to put ourselves in a space where God can talk to us. God, prepare us for our role in life. Moses grew up as an Egyptian royal, and then he became a shepherd in Midian, where he got to know the desert, got to know the nomadic lifestyle. And that made him the perfect candidate and gave him all the skills he needed to, on behalf of God's people, go and stand in front of the Pharaoh and in the end, ultimately, guide them out and lead them into the desert to the land of plenty that God had prepared for them. But it's important to know that it was no easy road for Moses. At times it was hard, very hard. God prepared you too. God prepared you to make a difference within the context and within the situation that you are in at the moment. Trust God and do your best. If things are hard for you at the moment, know that God has seen your struggles. God has heard your requests. God knows that things are not easy for you and knows the longings of your heart. God is aware of what you like to be different in your life. God knows your anxieties and your fears. God knows. Do your best to cope and work hard on solutions while fully trusting that God is with you and that God knows the bigger picture, that God has the situation in hand, and that God knows what is best for you. God used Moses to save the people of Israel out of Egypt, to free them from the slavery. God used Jesus Christ to save you and me from a dead-end, destructive existence, to free us from the consequences of sin. God proved his love for us by asking his Son to bear the consequence of our stubbornness, our brokenness, our disobedience, our rejection of God, and our self-indulgence. Jesus' suffering and death on the cross is the ultimate example that God is not about easy and quick fixes. Jesus Christ suffered. Jesus Christ died. But Jesus Christ also rose from the grave. Through Jesus Christ, God is guiding us to the land of plenty, the land of milk and honey, back into God's perfect presence, back to paradise. As we celebrate communion today, may the elements encourage us to fully trust God, to hold on to the salvation which is ours in Jesus Christ, and rejoice in the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Jesus Christ's body was broken to save us from our brokenness. Jesus Christ's blood was shed so that we will never be separated from God's love, no matter what our situation might be. As you eat the bread and drink from the cup, remember, whatever you may stress about, whatever you are struggling with, whatever makes you anxious or sad, or makes you feel helpless, frustrated, or angry, nothing of these things are greater than God, or greater than God's love for you. As you celebrate communion, remember that, and may God feed you spiritually through the bread and the wine. Amen. Friends, I'm going to do the institution of the bread, and then we will sing the first part of Behold the Lamb. After that, I'm going to do the institution of the wine, the cup. And after we use that, we're going to sing the second part of Behold the Lamb together. Friends, the bread that we break is our communion with the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. Take the bread you have, or whatever substitute you use. Eat that, and as you eat that, think about, remember, and believe that the body of our Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, was broken so that we may live.
Of our bonds are
Thanksgiving is our communion with the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Take this cup, drink from it, know and believe that the precious blood of our Savior, of our Lord Jesus Christ, was shed so that we may have life, life in abundance now, so that we may have life everlasting, so that we know God loves us completely. Let us pray. Glory, glory, glory and praise to you, Father, Son and Holy Spirit. Thank you for the sacrament you gave to uplift and strengthen us, to remind us of your love for us. Thank you, Lord, for the inspiration we draw from the sacrament. Help us forget about quick fixes to our problems and help us to unreservedly trust in you, your love for us, and the fact that you have the whole picture and our best interest at heart. That said, Heavenly Father, we need your help, your healing, your comfort and your guidance. You know what we struggle with. You know our addictions and afflictions. You know us warts and all. Draw us closer to you. Help us to be patient and faithful when life is not ideal. Help us to be truly grateful for all the beauty in and around us. Lord, help us celebrate each day in your name and use us to share what we receive from you wherever we may go. Amen. Friends, our final song is the response to God's word, a response to what God did for us in communion, and the song is, My Heart is Filled with Thankfulness. After that, we're going to finish the service again with the blessing, but this time a shorter version with the words on the screen as well, so you can sing along. Let's sing this song, My Heart is Filled with Thankfulness, as well as the blessing.
Of my disgrace and gave me life again, who crushed my curse of sinfulness and clothed me in his light and wrote his law of righteousness with power upon my heart. My heart is filled with thankfulness to him who walks beside, who floods my weaknesses and strengths and causes fear to fly, whose every promise is enough for every step I take, sustaining me with arms of love and crowning me with grace. Is my perfect peace, whose every thought is love. For every day I have on earth is given by the King. So I will give my life, my all, to love and follow Him.
Once again joining me. I hope that within a week or two's time we're able to gather together in the church and worship together and have fellowship, see each other's faces and smiles again. In the meantime, take good care of yourself and please let me know if there's anything that we can do for you. Take care and God bless.